Good evening. My name is Florence Selden. I am a member of the Board of Directors of a League of Women Voters Cape Cod area and the moderator for this program. For 101 years, the League of Women Voters has been a nonpartisan activist grassroots organization whose core mission is empowering voters, defending democracy. To that end, we encourage informed and active participation in government. We work to increase understanding of major public policy issues and influence public policy through education and advocacy. Tonight's program is in keeping with the mission to educate and inform the public, this time on the work of school committees, an elected independent body of local government. Too frequently, school committee elections go uncontested. And so this program is designed to inform prospective candidates and community members about the role of school committees in an effort to encourage people who want to ensure that we have quality schools in our communities to run for office. There is much discussion on the Cape about keeping and encouraging families with young children to live here, and having excellent schools becomes an important tool in achieving that goal. We have a very experienced, knowledgeable panel with us tonight. But before I introduce them, let me explain the format. Our keynote speaker will talk first for about 20 minutes, and the three panelists will speak for 10 minutes each. This will be followed by 10 minutes of discussion among the panelists and myself. And then there will be 30 minutes of responses to questions from our audience. All questions need to be posted in the chat, and please direct them to Karen. So again, all questions should be posted in the chat. Direct them to Karen, who is the League of Women Voters co-vice president for program and the organizer of this event. Our keynote speaker is Glenn Kuchar. Mr. Kuchar is the executive director of the Massachusetts Association of School Committees. He's a native of Cambridge and served on the school committee there for 12 years. He has a bachelor's from Harvard College and a master's of public administration from Suffolk University. With that, Mr. Kuchar.
Thank you very much, Ms. Selden. I'm really happy to be with you. I wish I could be there in person on the Cape, but maybe by summer we will. I'm going to share my screen with you, and I'm going to present a PowerPoint that will not be covered completely, but will be available to anyone who wants to ask for it. We'll be happy to send it to you. Some of the things we will cover a little bit later during the question period. And other matters will be raised as they come up. But I do want to start by explaining to you, and let's see if I can make this work now, the role of the school committee. The school committee in Massachusetts is the governing board for schools. It represents the heart and soul of the community and represents good and wise decision-making by people who really step up to be civically engaged. And they've been doing it in Massachusetts since the 50s, the 1650s. So we have a long history of Massachusetts local oversight of schools. Let's talk about the key responsibilities of the school committee. The school committee sets all the policy for the school district and all the forms that policy may take place. And we'll talk a little bit about that. The school committee hires the superintendent of schools, retains the superintendent, contracts and evaluates the superintendent, and they do it as a body, not as individuals. The school committees have a fiduciary responsibility, which is a duty of loyalty to the district and a duty of care. And the people's money is not spent without the school committee's approval. Those fiduciary responsibilities don't have direct responsibilities to education, The responsibilities for educating the children is also a key responsibility. But in a democracy, a fiduciary responsibility is part of the job. They are the employer of record for collective bargaining, doing the negotiations with the unions, teachers, custodians, paraprofessionals, cafeteria workers, whatever they may be. The collective bargaining negotiations are directed by the school committee. School committee members are advocates, and they advocate for children as a group and usually advocate individually as well. And their responsibilities as school committee members are as members of the board itself, not as individuals. Individual school committee members have very little authority on their own. They act as a board. Fiduciary responsibilities are important, as I explained. They include setting your budgetary goals, receiving a budget recommendation from the superintendent, determining the best budget, and including in the budget document the language that defines how the money is going to be spent. A key responsibility of the school committee and a very challenging one. Now, the superintendent of schools is the chief executive officer for education in the community. The superintendent oversees the operations of the district, appoints most of the staff, or supervises the people who appoint the rest of the staff. All of it is accountable to the superintendent. In the old days, prior to 1992, the school committee would have a role in doing this. Now the school committee's role has been yielded to the superintendents. And I have to tell you, that's probably the biggest reason that we've had such an increase in student achievement since 1993. It helped to take the politics out of a lot of personnel issues. School committee oversees, the superintendent oversees business, personnel, and academic functions, usually through the central office administrators and principals. The superintendent carries out all the policies that the school committee sets and administers the budget as determined by the school committee and approved by your town meetings. The superintendent also oversees the implementation of the union contracts, and that includes dealing with grievances, another challenging responsibility of the superintendent's scope of duties. The superintendent is hired, contracted with, and evaluated by the school committee. Now, think of the school committee as the legislature for the towns on the Cape and the regional school districts. Regional districts are considered independent educational municipal authorities. The authority is for the body, not for the individual members. Like legislators anywhere, they represent the entire district. So if one were a member of the of a two-town regional school district, that means that the school committee members would be responsible not to any particular town, but to the district, the regional district as a whole. It's the school committee members' obligation to serve the entire civic body. Terms are staggered, usually, and the school committee elects chairs and vice chairs, just like any other legislature. They establish the rules for the district, which are the district policies. They hire the chief executive, which is unusual for a legislature, as the superintendent of schools. They have the fiduciary responsibilities of approving budgets, which is what a legislature does. And in Massachusetts, they have the unique responsibility of being accessible to their constituents. The residents of Massachusetts have the constitutional right under the state convention, not only to reach out and petition their elected officials, but to instruct them in how they are to do their jobs. Now, if you're a school committee member and if you're thinking about running, just remember, when you become a candidate and if you are elected, you become a public figure, which means your privacy rights are a little less than the private citizen. And the people can say and write about you pretty much what they want, and you have little recourse. So if you have thin skin, just be very careful. And if somebody writes something you don't like, think very carefully about whether you want to respond and make a two-day story out of a one-day criticism. We can talk about being a public figure or later during the question period. There's also a balance of power between the school committee and the municipality, and we'll explain that. The school committee, for example, needs to go to the municipalities to have their budgets approved. There's a balance of power with the superintendent, in that the school committee makes policy and the superintendent administers it. The superintendent oversees the budget that the school committee sets. The school committee has authority to manage staff and hire staff, but if the school committee is dissatisfied with the performance of the superintendent, they can replace the superintendent at an appropriate time. So just think about the checks and balances that apply, including the checks and balances that apply with the municipalities. Your towns may have a say in approving the regional budget. You may have to go through the finance committee as a review of the budgetary operations. The town manages town business, which affects schools, clearing roads, keeping the schools safe, police and fire. And in some districts, the moderators appoint members of the school committee. That's the case in some of our vocational technical schools. So there's a balance of power that exists. There's a key to being an effective school committee member. And if you're elected, you'll be able to come to an 8-hour orientation that's free that we do for all newly elected members. We remind you that the key to being effective as a legislator, as a school committee member, is knowing not what you may do or what you can do, but what you should do. We encourage you to advocate for your constituents appropriately. We encourage you to disagree and criticize and dissent, but in a principled and civic way, civil way. We urge you to be transparent and make sure that the chair keeps the community alert and advised about what's happening in the meeting. The chair of the school committee is the servant of the school committee, not the master. And the chair represents not only the school committee, but the residents of the community who rely on the superintendent to explain the chair, to rely on what's going on with the meeting. Good school committees have priorities and build their budgets around them. They collaborate with the superintendent. You know, if there's a disagreement between the superintendent and the school committee, and if there's bitterness and tension, people pick up on that and bad practices ensue, especially in the schools. So collaboration is very important. Confidentiality is a big part of the job because you're dealing with a lot of confidential data. You have employees who have a right to privacy, and you have students and parents who also have a right to privacy when they're dealing with schools. Also, most school committees have effective meeting protocols that help them run efficient meetings. Now, where do you go for the rules? How do you find out what your school committee has to follow? Well, the Mass General Laws is the law books are very important. We provide books related to education law to all of our school committee members every year. We'll be happy to send them to you if you ask us. The State Department of Elementary and Secondary Education has voluminous regulations from their offices in Walden. District policies are also rules that the school committee sets for people to follow. There's a lot of federal law that applies to things like special education, privacy rights, due process rights for students, and things like that. Occasionally, we get decisions from the court. We can talk about this a little later because we've had some very interesting court decisions that have come up recently that affect schools. And there's Robert's Rules of Order, which is what most of you use to run your meetings. Parliamentary procedures are very important because they help you keep order. Dissent and disagreement are important. As Hubert Humphrey said, they're the anvil upon which democracy is forged. So we encourage you to argue, we encourage you to disagree, and we encourage you to remember that if the school committee did not hear an intelligent discussion about issues, they might not hear them at all. So very important to be a principled critic and a principled dissenter while you're trying to work together with your colleagues. Policy, and we'll talk about this a little later during the open discussion group, policy is found in a lot of different places in your district. So just some of them, district policy manuals, handbooks. School committees have a role in setting all those policies. They don't necessarily set them all because a lot of stuff that's in a handbook is administrative, but there are lots of places where policy is found. And this is available to you as a resource, and we can follow up if you like. Oftentimes, black and white become gray, in that the role of the superintendent for administrative authority and the role of the school committee for policymaking can blur and the lines can become vague. We encourage school committees and superintendents to work out the differences because the law gives you no guidance. We know definitely that the superintendent appoints the employees. We know definitely that the school committee sets policy. But where's the difference between policy and administrative regulations to implement the policy? There can be a fine line. And that's why we encourage superintendents and school committees to have these discussions about where the gray areas are. Lots of lines become unclear. The most frequent line that we will address very quickly is what happens when a constituent brings a problem to a school committee member. It's the school committee member's obligation to refer that constituent to the superintendent because the school committee has no authority over the employees of the district. The superintendent does. And the superintendent reports to the school committee, so parents are usually required or urged to send complaints and refer complaints to the superintendents. The work is very challenging. Budgeting is difficult. I doubt very much that any of you consider running for the school committee for the joy of cutting services and academic coursework to students. That just doesn't happen. Well, that's not why people run. Constituents will constantly reach out to you. There are a lot of special issue constituents that will demand your time. You're a public figure. And of course, in many of your Cape communities, everybody knows who you are, so you don't have as much privacy as you would like. The school committee has to make very difficult decisions with the constituents who are affected by those decisions sitting right in the room watching them. So there's that pressure. And as I said, roles and responsibilities can have their ambiguities. Financing is very important. You need to know where the money comes from. The state's Chapter 70 program is the largest source of general block grants to cities and towns. That's a whole other workshop. We'll be happy to come and explain it to you. Special education funding has a special program for high cost cases, but special education is expensive. Transportation costs are expensive. And there are federal funds that provide resources to you, but also have obligations for your services. You've heard of Title I. One of the things that's coming down in the next few months is a lot of money from the federal government from COVID remediation. And a lot of it is going to be sustaining us for the next 2 to 3 years. We'll be very happy to come and talk to you about school financing. And property taxes, of course, along with Chapter 70, is the biggest source of where your expenses come from. Good school committees monitor progress, ask the superintendents for financial reports, and discuss with the public how well they're doing. Many school committees have issue-oriented meetings where they find themselves the place with the table. And good school committee members understand the open meeting law, which requires that your meetings be posted and that deliberations be held in public, not at Dunkin' Donuts. Dunkin' Donuts is a nice place to go for coffee, but it's not where you should be deliberating, and it's not where you should be discussing with your colleagues school committee business. That's supposed to be done in public. School committees may meet in executive session, and we can talk a little bit about executive sessions a little later if people have questions about why school committees use them and when they go into them. School committee members are also subject to the state ethics law, which is very strict. And it's very strict around making sure that you do not profit individually and enhance your financial interests by being a member of the school committee. And it may require many people whose relatives work in the school department to abstain from taking certain votes because of the conflict of interest. The state conflict of interest law relates to bribes, gifts, number 3, taking care of relatives and friends, or number 4, acting by abusing your authority in a way that you don't have. School committee members that tried to end run the chain of command are actually running conflict to the conflict of interest laws. So we'll talk a little bit about bribes and other kinds of ethics violations a little later if time allows. But this is all on the handout, and that's going to be made available to you. Finally, I want to explain to you that there are people out there who are good role models for you to follow if you aspire to be a school committee member. If you don't know who that is, that's the mayor of New York City. He's a chief executive. He's responsible for overseeing public schools. That's Bill de Blasio, the mayor of New York. You all remember Colin Powell, commanding general, who was a good leader in tough times. Well, school committee service calls for good leadership. Some of you may remember Tip O'Neill, the Speaker of the House of Representatives, the United States House of Representatives, one of the founding fathers of our organization. Tip O'Neill wrote a book called All Politics is Local. School committee members have those constituents that remind you of that all the time. You also have to be careful of the news, the media. You're a free game. So if someone approaches you with a camera, I guarantee you I can make you forget the names of your children if I show up at the front door with a camera and start asking you questions. So be respectful of the press. Money is very important. You want to be very careful with it. As President Calvin Coolidge was tight with money and tight with words. In fact, he often said he spent words as he would spend money. Some people run for the school committee because they're out to get someone. And that's not really a healthy thing, but the reason we have her up there is for another reason that I'll explain in a moment. That's Catherine Clark. Catherine Clark is the third most powerful ranking member of the United States House of Representatives. Again, a woman in leadership who has been focusing on education. It's about kids, so we want to remember the captain and all the work that he did for children as school committee members act in the interests of children. We also want to remember, as I said, there's a lot of money coming down from the Congress, and that money is controlled by the chairman of the Ways and Means Committee of the House, Representative Richard Neal from Springfield. Senator Patty Murray is a very influential person, leader, in the Senate. She's dealing with education issues and someone that's very important for you to be following. And don't forget Ben Bernanke, the person who believes in long-term financial planning, former head of the Federal Reserve. But everybody up there also has another reason for being there. They're all former members of their school boards, all of them. In fact, as you can see, Colin Powell was on the Fort Monmouth School Board. Tip O'Neill founded the Massachusetts Association of School Committees. He's a former member of the world's second greatest deliberative body, the Cambridge School Committee. Calvin Coolidge chaired the Northampton School Committee when he was mayor. Michael Moore was elected as a high school senior to his school board. Richard Neal, who now handles most of the money going through the House of Representatives, started managing the money of the Springfield School Committee when he was mayor. Margaret Hamilton, the Wicked Witch, served on the Beverly Hills School Board. And when she passed away, she left her estate in trust at Wheelock College to benefit early education for children. And finally, well, Senator Patty Murray went to the United States Senate from the school board, so there's a career path for you. And Catherine Clark, who's in Congress now, as I mentioned, was on the Melrose School Committee. Ben Bernanke learned to micromanage as a member of the Princeton, New Jersey School Committee. And finally, just so that you know, the mayor of New York was formerly the student representative to the Cambridge School Committee, which is where he grew up. Bill de Blasio sat right beside me for a year. Unfortunately, he doesn't remember who I am, and I can't do anything in New York for anybody. But that's a quick look at the role of the school committee. People who will be of interest to you, will be role models for you. And let's get rid of the screen share and return the program to your host. That's 20 minutes and
Yes.
8 seconds.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kuchar. Appreciate that. Thank you. Most interesting. And the slides will be available. Our three panelists will now share their experiences and perspectives with you. We will hear from Jenny Landers first. Ms. Landers is the chair of the Dennis Yarmouth School Committee, a graduate of Dennis Yarmouth High School, Smith College, and Northeastern University School of Law. She is an attorney for the International Fund for Animal Welfare, a global animal rescue and protection organization headquartered on Cape Cod. The next speaker is Tina Gaines, who is the chair of the Monomoy Regional School Committee and also serves as the chair of the Harwich Cultural Council and the Cape and Islands Committee on the Status of Women. She is a public relations and strategic planning consultant for nonprofit organizations that focus on issues pertaining to the arts, culture education, women's empowerment, and girls' initiatives. She is the mother of two college students, both graduates of Monomoy Regional Schools. And finally, Michael Gradon, who served as superintendent of the Norset Regional School District for 17 years, the assistant superintendent for 5, and principal of Wellfleet Elementary School for 12 years. Since 2014, he has been superintendent of the Truro School District. Mr. Gradon has a bachelor's from Harvard College and a master's of education from Westfield State College. He lives in Brewster and as a sideline, is active with the Brewster Whitecaps, a Cape League baseball team. And so we'll start with you, Jen. Jenny.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. Hi, thanks for having me tonight. So I think I'll start just by saying a little bit about why I ran for school committee. And I also want to set my timer to make sure that I'm
great.
Too far off here on the timing. So when I moved back to the Cape about 12 years ago and began my career here as an attorney, I was serving on a lot of different boards of directors. I've always been community service minded and was serving on at least 3 boards of directors, volunteering for many different volunteer committees and also serving individually for many nonprofits. And it was a lot, and I needed to find a way that I could give back to the community, but in a way that would also, frankly, be serving my family. You know, I have a son he's now in 6th grade, and at the time he was, you know, younger. I'm now halfway through my second term, but I was spending a lot of time away from my family with all these volunteer commitments. And I realized that, you know, I wanted to not only be serving, as I said, my community, but also my family and my sort of smaller community. So I ran for school committee. And at the time, I won't say I was naive about going into it, but I was sort of naive about essentially the political nature of this beast. And as I said, I had served on boards and I had volunteered and I had been, you know, I had led organizations, but I wasn't necessarily prepared for how political this was all going to be. And running for office can be daunting, even running just for school committee. And I know that keeps a lot of people away from this. It's not just an appointment, it is running a campaign. And I was lucky that I had people around me to help me, people who volunteered to help me write materials and prepare the cards I sent out and my signs and help me put together my messaging. And that was crucial to have a small committee of people around me to help me put that together, as I was running against an incumbent who had been on the school committee for many years. So I know that running can be daunting, but I encourage anyone who's considering it to come to any of us who've done it and we're certain to have some suggestions and some support for you, a lot of support for you. You know, there are so many challenges, and, you know, I don't want to portray this as a negative, because it's certainly not. I fully enjoy serving on the school committee. I feel like I'm giving back in a very special way to my community, in a very specific way, and in a way that's really important to me and my family. There are many educators in my family. My mother was, my uncle is, my cousins are, my sister is, lots of teachers and professors in my family. I believe wholeheartedly in public education, and I want to do everything I can to make our district as great as it can be. We already have a great district, and we're working hard to make improvements. So the challenges, a lot of them come from the fact that this is a strange beast, especially in a regional district where we're working with two towns, two boards of selectmen, two finance committees. When we're looking at budgeting issues, we are also, you know, we are in the public eye, as Glenn said, and we conduct all of our business pursuant to open meeting law in public, on TV most of the time, or on YouTube, on the web, you know, wherever it's live streaming now. If it used to be in person, people could come watch us, and now it's live streaming on TV everywhere. And that can be daunting and challenging. You know, I had years of practice as an attorney standing up in a courtroom and speaking in front of people. So that has not been the challenge for me. But it also sometimes feels a little bit confining, because all of our work has to be done at those meetings that are posted with an agenda and a time in advance. So what you see is what you get. We are doing all of our work right there out in the open in front of you, for better or for worse. You get the good, bad, the ugly, everything that we need to talk about is going to happen in front of the public. And public participation at meetings is also challenging. You know, we have at the end of all of our meetings, time for public comment, but that also feels very confining and awkward sometimes. People come to these meetings and they want to talk about issues, and we're there to listen. But during public comment, and many of you know because you've come to meetings, you know, that's not the time to engage with us. The time to engage with us is reach out to us, email, phone, set up meetings, whether it's the school committee meetings or administration. And I know that that public comment period can feel very frustrating, because I attended school committee meetings as a parent, and I felt frustrated as a parent and as a citizen sitting at those meetings and not being able to engage in the way that sort of feels natural that you should be able to engage with your elected officials. But there are channels to talk to us, and that's really important. One of the questions that was posed to us was, how do we serve a diverse community? And I don't know the answer to that. What I want to say is that I realized last year that we were not maybe doing our best. We definitely were not doing our best in serving a diverse community, and we had issues arise, and I created a subcommittee, a diversity and inclusion subcommittee, which we've now started meeting, and we have administration staff, school committee members, community members, parents. We're going to have some student representatives. And we are going to have very frank conversations about diversity and inclusion, equity, diversity, justice in our district for students, staff, families. And we're going to learn on the committee. We're going to learn, we're going to get trained, and we're going to provide education, training, programming, and support for everyone in our district so that we can make sure we are serving a diverse community. Another question that was posed to us had to do with how can the community be involved, especially when they feel like the committee or committee members aren't doing their job. And, you know, you can come to public comment, of course, and voice your opinions as a member of the community, but that doesn't always feel satisfying. You can reach out to school committee members and administration and have meetings, but really, as we all know, in a democracy, your voice is your vote. So when you go to the polls, who are you voting for school committee? Or maybe you yourself need to step up and run for school committee, or find someone in your group of friends and family or community who are willing to step up and run. It's not an easy job. It's an unpaid job completely. None of us are benefiting in any way from doing this except the satisfaction of service and for creating a great school district for our students and our children and the other students in our community. So you use your voice, you vote or you run or both. There are not a lot of ways to, we've recently had some issues in DY with a school committee member making comments on Facebook that have been perceived as racist. And there has been some public outcry, as there should be, and people are looking for ways to handle this situation. And it's challenging. There's no direct mechanism. We don't have a recall provision. This school committee member, he's on our school committee until he potentially is off and doesn't get reelected. And that's currently the mechanism for that. And I know it doesn't seem right. And that's part of the challenge of working within the confines of how a school committee is set up legally and our policies and the law. I think people wonder how, am I over on time? Nope, I'm right there.
You're good.
Another thing that keeps people away from running for school committee is they're afraid of the time commitment. And I will tell you, I work full time at a very busy job, and I take care of my family, my son, my father. I have other commitments, within the community, and I still find time to serve on this school committee. It's possible, even when you're a busy person. And it's important that people in this community and all communities, that people who have skills and experience are willing to step up and run and make the time in their schedules for this. So I will leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you, Jenny. Tina, you're next.
Thank you.
Jenny, gosh, so many great things I want to build on. I wanted to first say, while I'm thinking about it, the League of Women Voters, I just want to thank you for your work, because I, two decades ago, started when my kids were teeny tiny, was involved in the League of Women Voters. This was in Alexandria, Virginia, and I got involved a lot at that time in educational issues. So it's kind of interesting when you start following your path and how you get to certain points in your life. But I wanted just to start and kind of roll this back a little bit about me and why I got involved. First of all, as Florence said in my opening, in my bio, I have two kids, both are in college. But my son, at a very young age, had learning differences. And I grew up with a mother in early childhood education, so I was very accustomed to being around education. And so I started asking questions. My mom knew a lot, and my son was on an IEP. For those of you that may not know what that is, it's an individualized education plan. He was on one from early on. So I had a lot of experience, and still do, as a parent of a child with special needs, as they call it. So early on, and I lived in Alexandria, Virginia at the time, I got involved, put my name forward, and was appointed to the Special Education Advisory Committee, and at that time to the school board in Alexandria, Virginia. So my early days were really in special education. And so I kind of learned and became an advocate for my son, got very well-versed in special ed. And so I say to some of you listening and thinking about running for school committee, it could come from a lot of different places, and it might even come from your own kids or grandkids or kids you might know, but my son is who opened the door for me, because I think until sometimes you have your own kids or maybe grandkids, you really think about the different ways kids learn. And I became fascinated, and that led me through the advocacy work that I did with special ed, TA president in my elementary school at the time, the kids' elementary school. And through the PTA presidency, I learned all the ins and outs of working with the administration and with the town and with parents. And so I kept building on that. And when we moved to Cape Cod 8 years ago, I jumped right in to, we live in Harwich. So I jumped right in to Monomoy. And at that time, the merger between the two towns of Chatham and Harwich was just happening. So I came in to that, not really having an attachment to Chatham or Harwich. I came in as Monomoy. And so I got to know a lot of people in both communities through my kids and became very, very interested. As Florence read, I serve on other commissions and committees in the area, in Harwich, on Cape and the Islands. So I have a background in advocacy, in service, and being on boards and commissions. And the school committee just kind of fell into my lap a couple of years ago when we had a vacancy. And I believe we're going to talk about that a little later, what happens when you have a vacancy. So we had somebody on the school committee 2 years ago that took a job in another state. So a position opened and I put my name forward and went in front and went through that process and was selected. So I started as an appointed school committee member for 4 months and then ran for a full 3-year term and got elected. And I just love it. I have to say, I've been on the school committee for 2 years. I was vice chair. I think I was 4 months in and was elected vice chair. And now I'm the chair. And I really, really love the work I do. And I have a political background. So I have a lot of the knowledge and the inner workings of some of the politics, as Jenny was talking about early, some of the politics of this type of position. You know, I personally have a comfort level with that. I know some people don't. You have to kind of work into that. I do have a background in public relations. So the public has always been important to me. I want to know, I always like to keep my finger on the pulse of what's going on. I mean, as a school committee member, as Glenn talked about earlier, it's not our job to really get involved in things, but I always want to know what's happening. So I'm very rarely taken by surprise if we have something coming in a public comment, because I like to get to know what's going on in the community. So for those of you thinking about school committee, you know, I just kind of ask, you know, what door you might come through. I remember when I was first appointed to the school committee, the Monomoy School Committee, and one of the selectmen at Harwich had said, when they were thinking about who to put into that position, because there were 4 candidates, and he said that you don't want a team of pitchers, meaning you don't want everybody coming to the table with the same experience. I think it's important as school committee members to have a variety of experience around the table, because I might see an issue through the lens of public relations that a couple of our retired educators on the school committee, they're gonna see it a different way. And these different perspectives really lead to really rich conversations. And I always feel as a school committee that with all of these voices around the table, and we have 8 members on the Monomoy School Committee, with all of the experience that we have sitting around that table, I always really feel good at the end of our discussions. And I know that we take our votes from a place of just a really good dialogue. So for any of you that don't have a background in education, don't let that sway you. If you have an interest in education, think about your own experience and how that might play out in a school committee meeting or on a school committee or in service of our kids and education and our families. I did want to note, and I am watching time, Florence, but you also, if you grow up too, I also, families have always been very, very important. One of the positions that I also have is on the Commission on the Status of Women. And because we service women, we also are servicing families. So families have always been very, very important to me. And as I serve Chatham and Harwich, and even our school choice students that come from other towns, I'm always mindful of families' needs. And so for me, education is the number one reason we're there, but we're also there to support our families. I mean, right now in Chatham and Harwich, you know, we're kind of going through some conversations right now about the needs of our families. You know, what do our families need? They need to be able to afford to live here. They need to be able to afford jobs here. So there are things that as school committee members, and I'll speak for myself, that I think are really important, even beyond education. I care about our kids. I care about where they're coming from. I care about their family supports. And one of the things that I'm always looking at, especially in our elementary schools, is our PTOs and encouraging some of our, if I get a constituent calling me about something, I always try to steer them to the PTO or to some of the school councils, you know, to talk with their peers. And that's also, I believe, is a job of a school committee member, is to make sure it, even though we ourselves might not be able to fix something, but we can steer them, whether it is a conversation with the superintendent or with the PTO. So I feel like we've got a lot of multifaceted things that we do on the school committee, even beyond what Glenn had shared earlier. He shared kind of the core of what we do, but there are other things that we do as well. And Florence, I think I might be at my time.
Got another minute and a half.
Oh, great. Wow. So I did also want to say, because Jenny alluded to, you know, working. We have 8 members, and out of the 8 members, 3 are retired. In fact, I think they're all retired educators. But we have 5 of us who are still working. And as Jenny talked about earlier, it's still a job you can do within your work hours. You know, how do I prepare for meetings was a question that was asked of us to come in to talk about this evening. How do I prepare for a meeting? You know, I think about this in the way I think about education. We all have our own learning styles. I'm an interactive learner. I have to be experiential. I have to be in the classroom, so to speak. And the Massachusetts Association of School Committees, of which Glenn is the executive director, has wonderful webinars. I was on one today, as a matter of fact, this afternoon, about the budget. So I'm always trying to educate myself as a school committee member, whether I'm reading something, attending webinars. I come at it like I'm in the classroom. And so I want to be prepared. I'm always, because I'm the chair, you know, I'm the one putting together the agenda with our superintendent, but I also want to make sure that I'm educated. And as the chair, I'm always sharing information with our school committee members if it pertains to something that I think is important for them to kind of study up on in order to have a good conversation. So educating ourselves as a school committee member is very, very important. And we all do it in different ways. And I appreciate how our school committee members show up for a rich dialogue in the way that they learn. And with that,
Tina, can you sum up?
Thank you.
Okay. Are you done?
I am done. Thank you.
Okay, great. All right. Mike Gradeau next.
Thank you, Florence. It's a privilege to share the podium tonight with such 3 distinguished public servants. A little bit of background to start with. I went to my first school committee meeting in 1970. No, I wasn't in the second grade then, I'm afraid. I've been to something over 1,000 of them. I did 1,000 during my time in Nauset because we did 60 a year for 17 years. And I can say very honestly that one of the lessons I learned slowly, more slowly than I should have, is that whether we agreed most of the time or not, school committee members are caring, intelligent, hardworking people, even when they were yelling at one another during a meeting. So we were invited to embellish our thoughts tonight with some stories. I'm going to have to be really careful because most of the people I've worked with over the last 45 years, I'm still here, and I respect what they did. The kids of the Outer Cape are great. Are their beneficiaries? So I want to be very respectful of that. Second, let's get past the idea, which I think Jenny and Tina buried. that being on the school committee is a one night a month. That has often served to persuade people to take out papers. But 3 or 4 months later, having been appointed to 2 subcommittees, had a special meeting on the budget, having been besieged by parents on one side of an issue or another, they come to you and say, hey, it's not one night a month. And yes, it isn't. It's a substantial commitment, as you heard from both Jenny and Tina. One other little bit of background. School committees are creatures of the state, not the city or town. When Glenn said the first committee met in 1650, that's because public education, public schools are in the state constitution. So while we often gripe about the state's interference, whether it's the governor closing schools last March or the commissioner announcing that we all had to go back in person early in April, or MCAS tests or whatever it might be, we all do our work because the Commonwealth of Massachusetts decided to make public education a local activity. But we get our authority ultimately from the state. And with that delegation of authority comes some responsibility to do as we're told. So most recently, we're struggling in many cases with how to open at least our elementary schools in person. We'll have that tug of war for the next couple of weeks, I'm sure. Getting to the school committee, when you work for 5 of them at a time, as I did in Nauset, you spend a fair amount of time breaking in new members. We would have orientation along with MASC every year for, it seemed like, 2 to 5 new members. One of the things they have to learn is that in many cases, they won because they ran unopposed. And that doesn't bring with it a strong mandate for whatever their personal opinions are. I agree with what Glenn said about a vigorous dialogue. But nobody comes to the table as a general rule with a phalanx of voters behind them representing the consensus of the community. That consensus for the public schools gets worked out at the table. And it's not always fun to participate in. Those of you who have been around for a while may remember in Brewster what we went through when the newer of Brewster's 2 schools, the Eddy School, was open. It was very unpleasant. Many of the feelings still exist today. There wasn't a right answer on either side of that discussion. But it's at the school committee table that those questions have to be brought up, have to be faced, and hopefully can be dealt with respectfully between all the parties and all the points of view that are involved. We have to remember that it's a committee. As Glenn said over and over, it's the body, the group, that has the authority, not the individual member. It's all well and good to make what you think as a member is a compelling case. But if you don't persuade a majority of the committee, when push comes to shove and the vote gets taken, it may go the other way. And as I said, it's important to be able to walk away respecting the people on the other side of the table. Sometimes that respect involves getting past the first reactions. I've done this long enough that I've gone from one extreme to the other. When I started in school administration, I was the passionate kid, and now I'm the dinosaur. School committees include both, and both bring the kind of perspective that Jenny and Tina talked about, cutting edge technology in education, which many parents are conversant with and comfortable with, or a commitment to traditional educational values as I grew up with them several generations ago. And ideally, a skilled chair can facilitate a dialogue that nurtures respect from everybody around the table for everybody else, no matter how different their opinions might be. The relationship between the two, I think Glenn highlighted nicely, the two being the school committee and the superintendent. I work for the committee. If I ever get to the point that I disagree so fundamentally with something the school committee's done that I can't bear it, then I leave. I'm an appointed official. On the other hand, I should have an opportunity to explain to the committee what I think is appropriate and try to understand them, nudge them in a little different direction, and come to a point where I can enthusiastically carry out what the committee's wishes are, and the committee comes away with an understanding of how their desires at a policy or budget level have to work when the rubber meets the road in a classroom with a teacher and kids. An important thing for committee members to do is their homework. Come to the meeting prepared. When you get an agenda, read it, and if you have questions, ask. We've sent out two fairly substantial documents to committee members this week for a meeting next week, because individual members raised questions over the previous 2 weeks about a couple of things we have to do. One is consider a new contract with our teachers union, and the other relates to enrollment in our preschool program. So we did some research in the latter case and compiled some data supporting our positions at the bargaining table, and the other, sent it out to all the committee members. Everybody's got to have the same base of information going forward. And ideally, we'll get to a meeting next week at which they're prepared to talk amongst one another and not argue what the facts are, but what we ought to do with those facts, the best way to move forward in our relationship with our teachers union is, the best way to run a good public preschool program might be. It takes continuing dialogue by well-informed people. So when you get the agenda, make sure you know it. Make sure you understand what you're going to be asked to do. And if it's not clear, ask in advance.
Good point to stop, Mike.
Yep.
Okay. Before we go to audience questions, there are just one or two things that we'd like to ask the four of you, and anyone can respond, or all of you can. So let me start with this. What are some good reasons for someone to want to serve on a school committee? Any one of you want to take that one?
Good.
Tina?
Well, I think the number one reason is to make a difference. You know, I think
anybody really looking to make a difference, and of course you can define that for what that means for yourself, but I think you want to make a difference. That's why a lot of people, I think, get into roles, public service.
Anyone else want to respond?
I'd always felt that the community in which I had grown up cultivated a culture of mediocrity, and I wanted to do something about that and raise standards and improve the quality of the faculty members so that they didn't happen to be people who were connected to politicians. And I was also concerned about the rights of students, particularly those students who didn't have an advocate. And I was, young and energetic and wanted to be an advocate.
Thank you. Here's another one. How did you learn about a vacancy on the committee? Jenny, how did you learn about it?
There was no vacancy, so to speak. I think my first step was the clerk's office. Terry Bunce, who's the clerk in Dennis, is extremely knowledgeable in all these things and very approachable and friendly and helpful. And I went and talked to her a little bit about the process of running and what I needed to do. I also reached out to all the current members, or a lot of the current members on the committee at that time, to talk to them about serving and what it would be like, and ran against someone who was running for re-election. So, I mean, there was a vacancy, but it wasn't an uncontested election.
Anyone else? I think it's a perfect time then before the questions for me to say this. If anyone is interested in, who's listening, is in running for school committee this spring, you should go to your town's website, particularly to the town clerk site, or as Jenny just said, call the town clerk and talk to her direct or him directly. On the website, you will find information about dates for taking out nomination papers, the number of signatures required, when the papers must be returned to the town clerk, and when the election will be held. Election dates differ from town to town, depending upon when town meeting is held and dates set by town charters. The town of Barnstable holds its election in the fall, the only town on the Cape to do so. And now, Karen, we'll turn to you, and may we have our first question.
I'm gonna start with two questions that are dealing with the campaign process. The first question comes from Rihanna, and she'd like to know, do people run as part of a political party, or if you don't do that, do you reach out to certain political party voters?
Does somebody want to take that first?
Most of the elections are nonpartisan in Massachusetts for local office. However, candidates will use a variety of endorsement strategies and work within, sometimes they work within the parties. Many times candidates will come out of the Democratic or Republican town committee activity base and will mobilize their town parties. But generally people do not run on a partisan basis.
Anyone else wanna, Jenny, you commented to pick up on this, continue it. You said something about it, you didn't realize how political. Did you mean partisan or political in a different sense?
You know, partisan to an extent when it comes to dealing with within the towns, the boards of selectmen and the finance committees, and not necessarily down party lines, but conservative versus more liberal viewpoints on certain matters. Yeah.
Anyone else? Karen?
A second question about the campaign process. Are there certain organizations that can assist people with learning how to campaign? If you don't have a background in politics or don't have the resources, are there organizations that can help you with that?
Both parties.
Go ahead, Glenn.
Run camps for candidates. Just who are interested in running in partisan campaigns, but the same skills apply. So you could contact the Democratic or Republican State Committee and learn about how to run a campaign. Now, there are other groups that may help people learn the issues. Certainly a number of groups that are engaging women in politics who are very active in doing that, and some groups that raise money for different constituencies will also help you.
Anyone else? Anyone of our current, Tina?
I'll add, not to single out women, but there are a lot of resources for women. Run, Vote, Lead, there's a lot. The Cape Women's Coalition, that's actually having an event on Friday. They're very involved in getting women. It's a nonpartisan group, very involved in supporting women to run for leadership positions in their communities, which includes the school committee. So I highly recommend them.
Anyone else? Is a campaign costly, Jenna or Tina? You've run recently.
Well, it depends what you consider costly, I guess, and it depends how you run your campaign. I think, I asked for donations. I created a campaign committee, and I had a friend who served as the treasurer, and I asked friends and family for donations, and I used that money to print flyers, and I got, and I purchased mailing lists from the town of voters. That's a nominal cost, and then paid for postage to mail out those postcards to voters in town, and also to print signs and put those out. So, it was, I think I spent $500 or something like that. And most of it came from small donations from friends and family and other people in town who wanted to support my campaign. So you could self-fund it, and you could also spend nothing. I mean, there are a lot of ways, especially now with social media, to do a campaign with little or no cost.
Thank you. Karen, next question.
Someone would like to know about the value of particular kinds of experience in terms of serving on the school committee. Do you have to have kids in the school system to run, or is it good to have life experience in education? And would that be appropriate even if you didn't have kids in the school system?
Someone want to take that first?
I'm happy to.
Go ahead.
A background in education can be helpful. If you have any experience in finance, that can also be helpful. People who've had experience managing personnel for collective bargaining is a helpful experience. But the school committee itself is an incredible learning experience for people who just want to do the right thing by kids and think intelligently about issues related to education. So there really are no prerequisites, but having good judgment and a strong element of maturity and patience make for a good school committee member.
Anyone want to add to that?
And I'll jump in
where angels fear to tread, having worked for a few school committees. It's been my experience that a balance of perspectives, that on a 5-member committee, for instance, a couple of parents are an enormous asset, people who know what's going on with the kids and parents in town. And similarly, it's good to have a couple of people who don't have kids in school, who may be the retirees that you talked about earlier, and have a different perspective on how the school department ought to run effectively.
Anyone else?
So I'll just add 2 things. It's, as Glenn said, it's good if you have at least an interest in education, but I also, and I did share this earlier and I'm going to share it again, that when I was appointed to the school committee, something that stuck out to me was a selectman's comment that said, you don't want a team of pitchers. So I say that if you've got an interest in education, that is, to me, is the number one thing, but don't discount the voice you can bring to the table. I have a background in public relations. I'm the only one on our school committee that does. And because of that, I see things in a very different way than maybe a former educator. And all of these experiences matter. They all matter, and they're all very healthy in a good discussion. So, because this is the one thing I see, and particularly with women that I know, there's a hesitation to run because you think, well, I don't have this experience. And I really caution you, if you've got an interest, do it anyway, because you can always educate yourself. You can always read. You can always go to webinars. You can always ask questions. So I just strongly say, if you've got an interest in education, don't be afraid that you don't have other experience, because I can trust me that you do in some way.
Florence, can I add one thing to that?
Yeah, actually?
I would almost say that less important than having experience with in education or knowledge of education would be business knowledge or human resources knowledge, or, you know, who knows, management experience. You know, our job as the school committee is to hire the right superintendent who hires the right people who educate our children and to set policies for a good learning environment. We're not educating the students. We're making sure that the people we hire are the best people to do that and that their policies in place to make sure they can do it the right way. So I would say, you know, any education experience is not required.
Thank you. Karen, next question.
Mr. Grajown referenced that committee members sometimes come in underestimating the time commitment involved in serving. What do you find is an average amount of time spent behind the scenes outside of meetings in order to be well-informed and prepared going into meetings?
You want to start with that, Mike, and then we'll see if people have something to add.
He's muted.
Oh, Mike, unmute yourself.
Thank you. Sorry about that. The background was that there's often more than one meeting a month when we get in a budget season, for instance. Since the pandemic hit, the Truro School Committee has met every 2 weeks, and there was always something new to take up. Beyond that, there are subcommittees, collective bargaining. If you happen to land on that subcommittee, you may spend another 2 or 3 days a month in active negotiations and some time in between preparing for your next session. So go in with your eyes open, because in a small committee with only 5 members, everybody's going to land on a subcommittee and have to make some additional commitment.
Anyone else?
The DY school committee meets twice a month, and sometimes there have been other meetings in between, emergency meetings for issues, and then everyone is on at least subcommittees, I would say. And when we're in negotiating years with the bargaining units, sometimes you're on 3 subcommittees. So between meetings, 2 regular meetings a month, and I have at least 2 to 3 subcommittee meetings a month. And then as the chair, I have, you know, calls every week working on the agenda and working through issues with the superintendent and the assistant superintendent. So, you know, it's hours, multiple hours every week, but it's, you know, it's not a full-time job, but it is a time investment.
Not to mention the community meetings that you attend, school functions where you're expected to show up, PTA meetings where they want you to appear.
Children's concerts, plays, graduation.
Yeah, and Florence, if I could also add, also to everything that has been said, very truthfully, you have to also be prepared for sometimes 3 and 4 hour meetings. I know very recently we've had a lot of 3 and 4 hour meetings, and we have a community forum in Monomoy tomorrow night to hear from our community about some decisions that we're thinking that we're going to be making soon. So there are those extra things added, and I'm a chair like Jenny is, and it is a lot of work. I'll be very honest. But I absolutely enjoy it. So it's kind of a give and take.
Thank you. Karen, next question.
Speaking of those night meetings, somebody wanted to know, why aren't the meetings on Saturdays?
Why aren't the meetings on Saturdays?
Why aren't they on Saturdays? Instead of the evenings.
Yeah. Anyone want to tackle that one? Jenny?
Well, you know, that's an interesting question. In Yarmouth, for instance, they've played with when to have their town meeting, whether it should be on a weeknight or on a Saturday. And, you know, there's probably no good answer to when you hold these meetings. You can't please all the people all of the time. But there are a lot of people who work weekends, I guess. You could also say there are a lot of people that work evenings. There's never going to be a perfect time. But I think that, you know, we also expect our administrators to be at these meetings, superintendent, assistant superintendents, principals coming to present, staff members. We need admin at these meetings to take minutes and run IT. So there are all these people that make a meeting happen, and we cannot expect all these people to work on a weekend. Occasionally they will, of course, if they need to, but there's a lot of staff support, admin support that goes into these meetings that wouldn't be appropriate on a Saturday, I would say.
We have found that Zoom makes it very easy for people to participate in the evening, whereas no one has to get out and drive anywhere. Also, the other interesting element is that people aren't in a hurry to get home because they're already home.
So Oh, sorry, Glenn. Okay.
I'm going to add real quickly. We actually have at Monomoy, and I don't know if this is the case over at DY, but some of our students are involved in our meetings because we have hybrid meetings. So we've got half the group in person and half up on the big screen in Zoom. And our digital media students, it's part of how they're learning. So they're involved too, and the schedule works for them. So like Jenny said, we really have to look to see who are we needing in the room? What support are we needing? What's the best schedule for all of these people? So you're really having to look at it as a whole.
Thank you. Next question, Karen.
All right, I'm gonna go to two questions that deal with the topic of diversity. First one, what is the school committee's role, responsibility for school performance on the Massachusetts Department of Elementary and Secondary Education report card? And does school committee review it publicly?
Wants to take that one.
The school committee is to be the place with the table to have discussions with the superintendent about what the data are showing, to use the data to measure effectiveness in how well you're achieving your goals, but not to rely on data as if it's etched in stone, and to educate the public and make informed decisions about student achievement.
Anyone else want to take that? Okay, Karen, next question.
How can we encourage a more diverse group of people to run for school committee? Is there any effort to inform immigrants or ESL communities about current openings?
Want to take that one?
That's an interesting question.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm going to take it because I will be very, I'm just going to say as a school committee member that I have noticed on Monomoy, we don't have a person of color sitting around our table. And I have actively started asking in our community, because we've got a couple, we've got an opening coming up on the Chatham and the Harwich side. And I have put some feelers out in the community because I would agree that diversity is very important. And I would like to see as many people come forward as possible. So that's a personal commitment that I've made. And so I'm actually personally taking action on that and putting feelers out in our community.
I'll tell you, it is my experience that many constituencies of underrepresented populations will come to us and say, why are we not represented? Why are we underserved? Why are we not starting to see a diverse faculty? And my response has always been the best way to ensure that elements of diversity are put into play and that the complexion of the district starts to change is when those underrepresented constituents engage in the political process. And then when one of those representatives gets the seat on the school committee, one is in a position to raise awareness and affect change. I saw it happen in my own political career as a member of the school committee in Cambridge, and I've seen it happen all over the state. The community has to be encouraged to step up and engage. Now that's a commitment of time. You have to go out and round up votes that might not be thinking about you as a candidate. And it's a big challenge. It takes a lot of energy to get out and run in contested races.
Anyone else want to comment on that question? Okay, Karen, we have time for another question.
If someone is a teacher or administrator in an alternative school in another district, is that a conflict of interest for them to run for school committee?
No, absolutely not. And by the way, we frequently get calls from superintendents or others who object to someone deciding to run for the school committee. You know, for example, my PTA president's going to run for the school committee. Isn't that a conflict of interest? Or I have a teacher who's going to run for the school committee in another town. Or one of my teachers' union leaders in another town wants to run for my school committee. Isn't that a conflict of interest? And we have a very clear, unambiguous answer. And that is the right to run for school committee is exclusively between the candidate and the voters and nobody else. Anybody can run, but you can't run and serve in a district where you are currently a teacher. Excuse me. You can't serve as a teacher and be on the school committee in the same district. That's a violation of state law. But otherwise, you can run any, if you're an eligible voter and a citizen, you can run for school committee at your discretion.
Thank you. Karen?
I think there's a simple yes answer to this question. Is there formal student representation on school committees? Maybe somebody could explain a little bit about how the student, how what a student representative does in the school committee.
Maybe Jenny or Tina, and then we'll go to Glenn. Do either of you have student?
We have a student representative who is quite active, actually. In the past, some of our student representatives have come to meetings and presented reports on what's happening. It's a high school student in our case. And just presented a report. Right now we have a student who not only presents a report on what's going on in the school with, you know, highlights of academics, sports, arts, everything that's going on, and especially with the pandemic, he's, you know, shared a lot with us about what's going on with the students. He also gives his opinion when we're having discussions, which is really important when we're talking about things going on in the schools. And he recently brought to us, he asked if we could add a second student, and we took a vote and we agreed to add a second student representative. It's someone who's going to be a class behind who will then move up the next year. So they'll have, you know, sort of 2 years to serve and mentor someone behind them, and also someone who might be involved in different interests, extracurriculars or subjects than he's involved in. So it's a nice balance. We're really glad to have the student representatives.
Tina, do you have...
We do not have a student representative on our committee. However, it is one of our school committee goals this year, interestingly enough, and we are exploring. In fact, I'll probably be reaching out to Jenny at some point to talk to her about how it's working. In the interim, our student council president does come every other meeting, and they have a place on the agenda of which they can present their report as Jenny had described. And then we have an opportunity to engage in a dialogue and have some discussion with them. But right now that's what we're doing, but we are looking into having a seat at the table.
Thank you. Glenn, do you want to say anything about it?
I think Governor Charlie Baker was student representative to the State Board of Education as a high school student.
Okay.
A lot of aspiring school committee members come from having served as students.
Karen, another question?
We have two questions that deal with the issue of reaching out to the ESL community. So I'm going to give this as a part A and a part B. Is there an effort to try to make the agendas and minutes available in different languages? That's part A. And part B, are there any towns on the Cape that offer different languages at school committee meetings as a way to keep a diverse community engaged when English is not their primary language?
Does anybody know the answer or want to take that?
I don't think there's a lot of it. I'm not aware of anybody who produces an agenda or minutes in a foreign language, although we've got some pretty sophisticated translation software packages out there that have the capacity to do it. So we might start seeing it.
I will add that one school committee, one school district sent me a copy of our flyer for this event in Spanish and Portuguese.
Yep.
So our NDYR superintendent sends out every announcement that goes out district wide to all families. It goes out in multiple languages. But as far as the school committee know, we have not been translating our agenda or our materials. but I think that that's something that we should include in our work with our Diversity and Inclusion Committee for sure.
Okay, I think, Karen, we have time for one more question.
Do the CAPE school committees or chairs ever meet as a group?
Want to take that, Tina? Mike?
Yes. Oh. We have, with the Massachusetts Association of School Committees, we have our division meetings, and I have certainly connected with other chairs through that organization, and I also attend two or three times a year different meetings that are now via Zoom. So yes, we have certainly connected.
Jenny, you want to add anything to that?
Our division is a good resource, and we always meet annually as part of the conference that usually takes place that we haven't had this year with the pandemic, but the division offers a lot of important trainings for all the districts within the division for sure.
I know there are many more questions in the chat. We have a record of those questions, and we'll have to talk, League will talk about how to deal with them, how could we respond and what we could do. So we can certainly handle that. Does anyone on our panel want to have say a parting word before we end?
Florence, if I might add, the very first political event I ever participated in was sponsored by the League of Women Voters in Cambridge. And it was chaired by Mary Newman, who's a legendary advocate for women in government. And I've always appreciated the nonpartisanship and issue orientation of the League. And we look forward to doing more things with you.
Thank you, Glenn. Anyone else want to have a last
word? Yeah, I'd like to commend Glenn for his leadership of the School Committee Association over the past very long time. I think everybody here has seen him demonstrate what an outstanding, useful, intelligent, caring resource that association is. Take advantage of it.
Thank you. I want to thank
my computer and ask Mike to say that louder so my wife can hear it.
It's recorded. You can play it back for her.
I want to thank the panelists. Thank you for your insights and your information. I want to thank all of you who joined us and those who asked questions. The League of Women Voters hopes that this program gave you all a better understanding of the roles and responsibilities of a school committee, and perhaps motivated some of you to consider running, if not this spring, then next time there is a vacancy in your town or somebody is coming up for a re-election and you wish to have a contested election rather than an uncontested one, so that the issues can be aired. So thank you all. Thank you, Karen. And everyone have a good evening. Be safe, be well.
Thank you, Florence.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you all.